Welcome to this second workshop in the series between the YASHK and HKYIC. So my name is Xuhui Huang. So I'm going to chair the talks in this afternoon. So as our tradition, we'll start with a short introduction from the Vic and Bobby. Please, do you want to give a...
So good afternoon, Dr. Bobby Liu, colleagues from HKYIC, distinguished speakers, ladies and gentlemen. So thank you for joining the second industrial workshop co-organized by the Hong Kong Young Academy of Sciences and the Hong Kong Young Industrialist Council. New technologies are playing an increasingly important role in our modern society. While many scientists and engineers at the universities are exploring frontier research topics, industrialists are looking for opportunities to apply new technologies to increase their productivity and make new products. However, there's often a lack of communication between the two communities, between the researchers at the universities and people in the industry. For this reason, the Young Academy and the Young Industrialist Council would like to bring together top researchers and industrialists to explore the latest research topics in innovation and technology. So today, we will have distinguished speakers talking about the latest developments in AI and also the progress made in training our next generation engineers at HKUST. So we are also honored to have a large number of very successful industrialists in the audience. So in this workshop, Professor Pascal Fong will talk about how AI can help us to manage information in the age of COVID-19. And Professor Ronald Loy will talk about image processing applications using advanced mathematical and computational techniques. Professor Kai Chen will talk about how your personal data can be used by AI in a productive way, but at the same time, enabling your privacy to be protected. The last speaker will be Professor Tim Wu, who will talk about how students are being trained in his robotic team, which has won numerous major international and local awards in robotic competitions. The topics today are both important and interesting. I thank our Vice President, Professor Xuhui Huang, and our colleagues from the Young Industrialist Council, and particularly our speakers for making this event possible. Let's welcome Dr. Bobby Liu, the President of the Young Industrialist Council, to give a welcoming speech. Thank you. Dr. Liu, please.
香港青年科學院Vic教授你好，各位教授、各位會員、各位公益界朋友大家好。繼今年6月份第一次我們和YC和青年科學院開始的第一次的Industry Workshop之後呢，這次是第二次。上一次的Workshop呢，大家都覺得很精彩。上一次邀請了4位學者和業界朋友呢，分享了很獨到的見解和最新的知識，豐富了大家在能源方面的知識。 相信大家都很期待今天的workshop。在此我代表YASK歡迎各位參與今天的Industry Workshop。由於疫情關係，限聚令的實施，人與人之間的接觸會減少，我們今天這個workshop都是要用網上形式進行的。今年的疫情大家都清楚，反反覆覆，對我們的市民的影響是相當之大。生活裏面都有很多改變，大家都適應了不單只是work from home， 還有是 buying from home， learning from home， 在家工作。這方面的新常態都造就了很多新的商機，當然大家會利用到很多機械人、人工智能的設備，好像巡查、檢疫、量度、體溫這些都已經很平常。所以在這方面的角度來說，新商機是存在的。為了迎合這個轉變，我們 新常態，我們今天都是Industry Workshop，是以人工智能與機械人技術的發展為題目的。我們特別邀請了4位在這個領域裡面很深研究的專家學者。剛才Vic都亦都是逐一介紹過，簡單介紹過這幾位學者，我都不去詳細講了。相信這幾位學者都會跟我們分析最新的情況。YASK和青年科學院有著一個共同的特點的。 大家都係由一班志同道合、為事業打拼同埋好有熱誠嘅年青人組成，加上大家嘅理念非常之相近，專注喺下一代培育更多青年人喺多方面嘅發展。協會亦都希望加強我哋雙方面嘅合作，能夠等YASK嘅會員啦、工業界嘅朋友啦，甚至一啲對科技有興趣嘅年青人係可以一齊學習，加強企業院校。 科研機構之間嘅溝通，甚至將新嘅科技發展帶入呢啲市場業務裏面嘅，共同推動產學研呢個好重要嘅發展。我衷心希望日後YASK 同埋青年科學院有更多唔同嘅各方面合作交流啦，期待將來有唔同嘅 workshop 更多嘅議題會為大家送上嘅。最後，我代表 YASK 希望非常感謝 香港科學院嘅支持，今日嘅活動能夠令到大家能夠共同做好呢個 workshop， 亦都係感謝香港科技大學提供一個咁優質嘅場地俾大家去做呢個講座嘅。喺度我亦都係再次感謝參加今日嘅呢個講座嘅網上嘅朋友。好啊，多謝各位。
Thank you very much for the welcome speech from the Vikan and Bobby. So I think next we're going to move on to our scientific talk section. So the first talk will be given by Professor Pascal Fang through the Zoom. Professor Fang is currently the director of the Center for Artificial Intelligence Research at HKUST, and also a professor of both ECE and computer science. She's going to talk about how to manage and dispatching the misinformation in the time of COVID-19. So without further ado, let's welcome Professor Fang. Pascal, are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready. Hi, everyone. Sorry, I'm on Zoom, but the advantage is that I can show you different systems. So I'm going to share the screen of my talk first, and then I'll hope to show you a live demonstration of the system. So what I'm going to talk about today, the first part is I'm going to talk about a information management system. And this is a very pressing challenge that we met. So in about March 2020, we saw an explosion of scientific publications on the topic of coronavirus. So this was January 2020, and there was an explosion of coronavirus publications. And then scientists around the world were rushing to understand the virus, and they were trying to work on the vaccine. So it became very challenging to look through scientific publications about coronavirus. And therefore, around March, the White House of the US and a coalition of research groups prepared this COVID-19 open research data set. At the time, there's 138,000 scholarly articles, including over 69,000 on COVID-19, SARS, and so on. And you can imagine that medical workers and the researchers, it's very difficult for anybody to read all these papers. So, but this was the first time there was such an open data set. It was the most extensive literature collection. And so on Kaggle is a platform for Open Challenge. These organizations basically launched a call for challenge. They call upon all the AI researchers in the world to come up with a system to help medical researchers and health researchers to ask questions and to research on this, at the time, 40,000 papers, and now over 100,000 papers, right? So me and my team, we answered the challenge in March. And the final competition took place on the 16th of April. And our team, our system actually won one of the 10 tasks. We were the champion of one of the 10 tasks out of 1,000 teams participating all around the world. So I'm going to introduce this system to you. So what is it? So this is the volume of publications we saw, scientific papers that was being published at the time. So there was a lot. So how can you manage this information? We need to have a search engine. So you were saying, how come you cannot just use Google search engine? Google is a keyword search engine. So if you want to search through scientific papers, one keyword cannot tell you enough, right? So it's not good enough to use Google search. And also Google search doesn't summarize the answers for you. So what we did, we answered this challenge, cargo challenge, and we work on this COVID data set. And sorry. And then we came up with a system called CARE COVID. CARE stands for Center for AI Research. So it is a neural question answering and multi-document summarization system for COVID-19 scholarly information management. Neural means it uses a neural network approach. And this is basically the approach where user issues a query and our engine retrieves the document using a first round of keyword-based search engine. And then with a huge amount of search document, we implemented a neural question answering system to answer the questions. And then we rank the answers and we have two summarizers. One is neural abstractive summarizer and one is extractive summarizer, and provide the summarization system to the researchers. So these are some of the details of the implementation, but I think what is more important is for you to see a demonstration. So let me try to do a live demo, and I hope you can see how it works. So stop, and then I'll share the system. So this is a system, COVID, CARE COVID. So what you can do is you can ask questions like, what do we know about asymptomatic transmission of COVID-19? This is a question you cannot really use Google to find the answers to. So suppose you ask this question. So our engine returns, okay, the scientific papers that contains the answers. So here are some of the answers it contains, okay. So what are the asymptomatic transmission of COVID-19? So for example, here it says clinical features of COVID-19 children include fever and cough, but a large proportion of infected children appears to be asymptomatic and so on. And then you can go into these detailed papers that were published on this topic. So this is the original paper. You can read about it for researchers. And then when you come, so our system, having found these answers, it will highlight the answers in the scientific paper. It also summarizes into two summaries. And one is extractive summary, which is basically taking all the sentences, put them together. And this is a neural abstractive summary, right? So here, so these are the answers about this topic. And for example, what is the role of the environment in COVID-19 transmission? Again, here you have these answers. For example, the study explains, actually, I'm not sure. Can you see the, is it big enough? Is this big enough? Can someone tell me whether you can read from your side?
Maybe a slightly larger font will help.
Larger font, how do I zoom in? Okay, zoom in, okay. Large enough. Okay, here. So the summary tells you that the study explains the geo-environmental determinants of the accelerated diffusion of COVID-19 in Italy, suggests general lessons learned for strategy to cope with future epidemics, and so on. So it comes from these scientific papers, and we found the answers. So this is our contribution, basically, to the scientific community for looking through the scientific studies on COVID-19. Coming back. Let me share the original slides again here. So coming back to our presentation, what I want to show you again. So there are three parts, right? The first part is the search, and then the second part is question and answering, all right? And we call this a QA model. It is using a neural question answering model. Neural means deep learning. Maybe you have heard about it. And our answers perform better than other existing methods. And then there's answer fusion. We put two QA models and with different evidences, and then we put them together with a fusion. So for example, what is the role of the temperature in COVID-19 transmission? Then we fuse two answers from the same paper together. We have an answer re-ranking. And then we have this multi-document summarization, All right. So with the query, we then use two summarization algorithms to put them together. So these are summarization systems that give you the final summaries. And the details of the abstracted summarization is what we call the encoder-decoder architecture, where the neural network takes the input. It was trained on input output. So it was trained on the article and answer or an abstract. So you can read a lot of scientific articles and it's abstract and train the system so that now you give it any documents, it will give you a summary of abstract. It's an abstract of summarization. So this is what we did. And this is another, and since we have to summarize from multiple documents, this is called multi-document summarization. And then the second summarizer does not use deep learning. It uses something called extractive summarization. It finds the most salient sentences from the documents and then give you the other summary. So we have two summaries from two different engines for the researchers to look at and choose from. All right, so here is another, the final example. I already show you the demo, so you can take a look. So this is two different answers for the same question. One is from the neural deep learning engine, one is from the extractive engine. And they give you a slightly different information, but they complement each other. So this way researchers can look at it and then they can just go and read the paper furthermore if they're interested. And that saves a lot of time for researchers to go through the papers and for them to continue the research. And today, this system, we are actually collaborating with the Epidemic Intelligence from Open Sources platform. This is an organization under the World Health Organization. So we're collaborating with the EIOS system to provide such a question answering summarization system to their platform that allow various health ministries and Center for Disease Control all around the world to access the information from relevant to prevent epidemics. So it's not just for this epidemic, but also for future epidemic prevention, because people can look at also not just scientific papers, but news around the world, and then they can capture the early signs of something's going wrong. For example, EIOS system, the first time they reported something strange was in December 2019. They reported that there were some kind of abnormal cold or flu-like disease breaking out in Wuhan. So WHO actually saw that in December 2019 already. So this is the kind of system that uses AI to help epidemic prevention and research, right? So the second part of the system, so this is the, again, the some of the examples, right? So we already saw this example, you know, what is the seasonality of COVID-19 disease transmission? This is not an ordinary kind of search, you know, it's not searched by the lay people, but by researchers. So the language is very specific. And so here, these are the specific answers. Right, growth rate decreased with temperature. The growth rate was affected by precipitation, seasonality, and warming, velocity rather than temperature, and so on. So you can find this in the research, right? How contagious is COVID-19? This is the answer. The R0 is between 2 and 4. Without effective containment measures, an infected person can infect between 2 and 4 other individuals. This was all done by researchers in research papers. So very early already, people know a lot of these things. You just have to be able to find it, all right? The second challenge we were facing is that, by March 2020, we hear various kind of rumors on the internet or misinformation, right? For example, people were saying that if you drink bleach, it can help you prevent COVID-19. And there are just so many misinformation on the internet. And the WHO felt compelled to have a website where they debunk some of the misinformation. So we thought we needed to build in the misinformation debunker inside our system as well, to expose the falseness of a given claim by extracting relevant evidence. The idea is very simple. since we have these scientific papers on COVID-19, right, we can say that if you have a statement that is not supported by the scientific papers, then we can say there is no scientific evidence. For example, there is no scientific evidence that drinking bleach can prevent COVID-19. Because we look through all the scientific papers, we find that it's this is a misinformation. Okay, so debunking misinformation is just as important as managing information for lay people, because people can die from following misinformation. So here, this was the news, right? A man fatally poisons himself while self-medicating for coronavirus, right? And Brazil said that our biggest problem is fake news. Experts debunk dangerous myths about the coronavirus. So they are actually dangerous, you know, and normal days, even not during epidemia, not during the pandemic, there's a lot of misinformation about, for example, cancer cures, right? You drink this, you won't get cancer. You do that, you won't get cancer. And don't go to the doctor because they'll kill you. So this is very dangerous. So the second thing we did, so this is the WHO website on Mythbusters. So if people, for example, can shoes spread COVID-19 virus, right? So they will say the likelihood of COVID-19 being spread on shoes infecting individuals is very low. So we want to do this kind of thing automatically. So we use something called language model perplexity. The idea is very simple. I won't go into details, but the idea is very simple. It basically, if you think about it, you understand. Misinformation is a piece of text that contains false information regarding the subject, all right? So for example, if you see a sentence that starts with 5G communication transmits, okay? If you predict that it will say transmits information, then the likelihood is very high, 0.7. Yes, 5G communication transmits information. But if you say 5G communication transmits COVID-19, this is misinformation. It's not logical. Something like this, the likelihood of such occurrence is actually very, very low, 0.002. So if you look for this statement, 5G communication transmits COVID-19, in medical research, you will find it to be unbelievable, right? So that's the idea. We look at a statement and then we look for the likelihood of this occurring in the evidence body. And if it's low, we say that's misinformation. If it's high, we say that this is most likely reliable. So that's the idea. So this is actually, which tells you that if you look at a statement and you feel like, doesn't sound right, right? Whenever you look at a misinformation, usually you feel like, doesn't sound right. And indeed, if it doesn't sound right, it's probably not right. Okay, so that's the idea. And the details using language model perplexity to measure. And we constructed two databases that we'll release publicly. And again, we construct evidence, body of evidence, and using evidence selector and so on. So these are the implementation details. And then these are the different steps. So for example, claim the main way the COVID-19 spreads is through respiratory droplets. And in fact, the evidence is there. So these are three main evidences in scientific papers. So then our system will say, okay, you find the evidence and the likelihood that this statement is true is very high. So the label is true, right? And if you say something like ordering or buying products shipped from overseas will make a person get COVID-19, we go through the scientific papers and it's very unlikely, okay? Sunlight actually can kill the novel COVID-19. All these statements by our system are found to be false claims by our system. These statements are found to be true claims by our system. So this is what we call the misinformation debunking. So information management, misinformation debunking. Before I wrap up, I want to actually show you another system we did recently. I'm not sure I can show you live because my computer in the office is too old. My laptop is new, but I just want to share this with you. We're very excited about. It is actually a robot or a virtual agent that helps people who are in quarantine. So we have many students. I have many students who came back from China at the beginning of the year. And they had to be quarantined for 14 days in the conference lodge, right? And from their experience, we actually constructed a robot that will talk to you for 14 days, talk to you every day for 14 days, ask you about the temperature and detect you the mood and lead you through exercise, meditation, and so on. So this is a system called, it is Nora for quarantine. And I actually hope that we can, let people use the system. So any of the people in the audience, if you're interested in the system, please let us know. Our Center for AI Research is very happy to provide a free usage of this system for people who are in quarantine for 14 days. And because it helps you monitor your mood, monitor your temperature, your breathing, and also helps you through a daily routine of well-being and so on, and talks to you. I don't have time to demo this, but if you're interested, you can contact me and I'll be very happy to do demos, demonstration, and hope people can use it. So that's it for my talk. And please, if you have any question, I can answer the questions now.
Thank you very much. A very nice talk. Should we give a... And the timing is also very good. I think we have about 10 minutes for the discussion.
I cannot hear you. Can you speak louder?
Did I turn on the voice here? Can you hear me now?
Yeah. I think it's just the mask. It's harder to hear when you don't have a mask.
You can imagine how we do the mixed mode teaching. We have to speak three hours in a row.
Hard.
Okay. So I think we have about 10 minutes for the questions. So maybe
you can also ask me question in Cantonese.
Yes.
可以講廣東話，我唔知個 audience 係講廣東話定英文，但係兩個都得，國語都得。 也可以講普通話, so any language.
Okay, so maybe we start with question in the audience here.
聽唔到。
How about this, Pascal? So maybe the
You can repeat the question.
There are a couple questions in the chat. Maybe I can read Rose's question to you first, and then meanwhile we'll switch to the let the audience to think about other questions. So the first one will be how the AI helped in your system. I think this is not really okay. This question is valid. How to deal with false information or false statement in the scientific papers.
Scientific papers, these are peer-reviewed scientific papers, okay? And we, as scientists, we always rely on peer review in reputable journals. We think that's a very good gatekeeper. Our system is not trying to detect false information in peer-reviewed scientific publications. We trust the peer review process in reputable magazines. But of course, there have been cases where papers were withdrawn, right? But our system doesn't do anything like that. We rely on the peer review process. Okay, publication. These papers were all published in reputable journals and venues.
But you can detect the contradictory conclusions from the different scientific paper, but you just don't label them, right?
We won't. Like, if you ask a question, we'll present the most relevant answers. And if they're contradictory, then the researcher has to go through and read these papers themselves. All right, we provide a link to the original source.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Vic. Or...
So will there be a collective results, like a database in the future, which we can make use of these papers or the results of this whole research?
So this is very important because all the research papers were provided by this COVID-19 database. Okay, Microsoft, OpenAI, these organizations, they got together and put all these resources together and open source. In general, these medical information are not open source to anybody. But this time, they actually made it open source. So, and I think that's very, very important. That's a very good lesson we're learning, which is that scientific research has to be very open so that there can be more people who collaborate. So, for example, without this resource, we couldn't build our system and other teams could not build their systems. And today, Google, Amazon, and Facebook all build their different versions of system on this for this search. So now scientists have a very good access to these papers. But without this centralized open resource, we couldn't have done that. So I hope in the future, medical community can consider this, for example, for other kind of research, such as cancer research, Alzheimer's research and all that. Today, many publications, medical publications are behind a paywall and they cannot be aggregated together like this. So that's another lesson we're learning.
So one more question. Along the line of the first question, how do you recognize, I know there are papers that exist and there are new informations from new papers, but if it is something completely new, like COVID-19 is completely new and we are, let's say the vaccines, how do you recognize whether it is actually real or not? Is it from a team of medical expert? But even the medical expert doesn't know because it's completely, completely new. So how do we solve that problem?
Our system doesn't try to solve that problem, right? We rely on scientific publications. So all these papers are published. They have been peer-reviewed and published in reputable journals. So we trust these journals, we trust the peer review process. We don't try to find out whether it's true or not. Because our system actually doesn't have anything to do with COVID-19. It can be a system used for other kinds of information as well. The algorithms are just trying to sift through the information, do the question answering and summarization, right? So it's a more sophisticated engine than a search engine, but it's just an engine. It doesn't make value judgments on its own. And I think that's the correct way of using AI. All right?
Yeah, thank you.
Any fee to be accessed to no fee?
Hi, so Professor Feng, you are an AI expert. So I'm just wondering, can you tell us a bit more behind the scenes? So how AI play a role in your program, in your search engine?
So, like in my my talk, I talked about the question answering engine. Question answering engine is based on a big, gigantic neural network. And neural network is what people call deep learning. So neural network is a connected network of many parameters, many mathematical formula. And then we train the system with medical questions and answers that were collected previously in the medical domain, but for other content, not for COVID-19, right? So we have this training database. We train this neural network to have the ability to answer questions given scientific papers. And then we use this engine on the COVID-19 database. Similarly, the summarizer was trained on medical papers, and every medical paper has abstract. So this summarizer was trained on other medical papers with their abstracts, and then they learned the ability to summarize. So now you give it the answers from the question answering engine, then the summarizers then summarize them into abstracts. So the AI is the machine learning part, essentially.
Thank you very much. It's very clear. So I have another curious question. So what kind of computational power that you're talking about for your
machine? Oh, that's a very good question. So actually, once we build that system, we were submitting to the Cargo website because Cargo, you know, it was an open call. It was a competition, right? And 2 days before we submit the system, we realized it was way too slow because the neural, you know, deep learning systems are very, very powerful, but they are very slow because there are a lot of parameters. We realized that the system could not answer questions in real time. It cannot answer right away. It would take like too long, 10 seconds to answer. 10 seconds is way too long, right? So we actually sent an email to HKUST, like, the ESEC department, CSC department, ITSC, and say, we need machines. We need machines to learn this system because our machines are not powerful enough. So finally, UST, you know, our department put together BT100 GPUs for us to use, and then the system can run in real time. So it does require GPUs and powerful GPUs that my lab didn't have. And I had to ask UST to come up with something. So that was important, yes. All right.
Yeah, so if you have questions, you can step forward to ask questions. Use the microphone here.
Sorry, we forgot to arrange the.
Yeah.
Hi, Pascal. My other question is, apart from the COVID situation, what is the next best application for your AI machine that is in your mind? And
I couldn't hear you. Can you repeat your question? What is the next what? I couldn't hear.
The next best scenario, not the COVID document summarization, any other application in your mind that will help the world a lot. And for example, I'm wondering, in the world, basically we have too much patents already, and a lot of them are junk patents.
I see.
And will it be possible that if you're using your machine and ease out the researchers' time in mining the patents, especially those are irrelevant but seems to be relevant patents, will that be possible?
First of all, I don't know if all patents are open source. Is there API to all the patents? So we need, like, if it's open source, we can use our system.
I'm talking about the already prior open source patents. You know, when we are doing research, sometimes we have to get our team to read it, and they just find out there will be 2,000 boxes of documents. I mean, if they're all printed out, and it will take them maybe 2 years to read those documents, and the research maybe only 2 months.
I think that would be a very good application if we can get the API for access to all these patents. That would be a very good application indeed.
I think if this can be your next project, I think a lot of people here will be very delighted.
Really? Okay. Well, please contact me. We can discuss this project together.
Delighted? Do you have this? Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah, indeed.
So I think the opportunity of collaborations arise here. Yeah. So, before we end up this section, maybe I read one last question from the Zoom. So there's one of the question here is, who can have access to the system you presented? And any fees associated with this system?
No, there's no fee. No fee. But who can access? It's actually a very question. Everybody can access the system, but it is designed for expert use, meaning that we assume you're a medical researcher. So you ask questions that are like research oriented, and then you ask in a language that's more research oriented, not like, not in layman terms. So how to translate layman terms to research language and vice versa is another research challenge that we would like to tackle in our future work.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you. Lisa, thank you again for Professor Fang for the nice talk and the discussion afterwards.
Thank you.
Okay, so then we should move on to the next one.
Yeah.
Let me print. Okay, so our next speaker is Professor Ronan Noy from the YASHK. He's a professor of the Department of Mathematics and also the Executive Director of Center for Mathematics Artificial Intelligence. He's another expert of AI. And he's going to talk about industrial application of geometry and its recent advances. Please.
Okay, so first of all, I'd like to thank the organizer for the very kind invitations. So it's really my great pleasure to have this opportunity to share about my research over the last few years. So I'm actually working on applied mathematics. So even though I'm from the math department. Oh, okay. So is it okay? Is it okay?
The screen is not shared.
The screen is not. Oh, okay. You have to share. Oh, yeah. Sorry. Oh, okay. Oh, yes.
That one in the middle.
Okay.
full screen.
Okay, yeah. So I'm actually working on applied mathematics. So even though I'm from the math department, but my mathematics is not so scary, not so abstract. So over the years, I've been really interested in applying mathematics to real-world applications. So in particular, I'm really interested in applying topics in mathematics, differential geometry, to some real-world practical applications. So the topics that I'm going to address today is industrial applications of geometry and its recent advances. So this is sort of my outline. So I will first of all talk about the motivations. And then I'm going to talk about some very basic mathematical background related to quasi-conformal geometry, which I'm using. So I understand that most of our audiences here are a lot from academia, so I will try to minimize the technical details, but I will focus more on the applications. Okay. So let me first of all talk about the motivations of my research. So the main motivation of my research is to do 3D imaging. Yeah, so basically the availability of 3D data is becoming more and more ready. So in recent years has witnessed rapid developments of many different type of 3D camera. So for example, one of the 3D camera that we have heard of maybe Kinect, MakerBot. So these are actually 3D cameras, very famous. And actually recently, over the last few years, so a group I have been collaborating with for a long time, so has developed a 3D camera based on differential geometry. So the idea is actually very simple. So basically what we did is that we can actually shoot some vertical straight light to your surface. So because your surface is curvilinear, right? So when you hit the light to the surface, then the straight line becomes some curve, right? So by studying the curvature of the geometry, the geometric patterns of this curve from different angles, then and also by solving some kind of partial differential equation in mathematics, so and then we can actually reconstruct the 3D position of the 3D object. So this is a video showing you the ideas. So basically, we hit some vertical line to the surface. And if you have different deformation, different facial expressions, then your straight line become some curve. And by studying the curvature of the curve, then we can solve some mathematical equations. And because we can also develop some computational technique, then we can actually reconstruct the associated 3D position of the 3D objects. So surprisingly, using geometry, we can actually capture 3D object quite accurately and quite efficiently. So this is actually quite encouraging for us. So this is another video showing you. So we can actually capture 3D facial geometry with dynamic expressions with really high speed and high resolution and high accuracy. So, and also you can see all the expression can be captured quite well, and also the texture on the face can also be captured quite well. So here is another example. So we see that the texture can also be captured quite well. Yeah. So this system was developed by that company. So the first generation is a really, really big machine, like that big. but after 1 or 2 years, then it's become much smaller. And now it's like this size. So it's very small 3D camera. But yeah, so the reason why I show this 3D camera is that this is actually our first motivation and encouragement. Because from this 3D camera, we are convinced that differential geometry in mathematics can be a useful tool for us to handle 3D imaging problems. If we understand the geometry, if we can do computation on the geometry, then we can actually get really accurate result in 3D imaging. Yeah, so I guess the main motivations is that we would like to handle huge amounts of dynamic 3D geometric data with large deformation. And then we are convinced that differential geometry can play a role. Okay, so in particular, we are trying to use something called quasi-conformal geometry to handle the problems. And after that, we have been trying to talk with different people from different fields. For example, from computer science people, from medical people, and so on. And then we realized that a lot of problems, for example, in computer vision, in computer graphics, even in medical imaging, so all the problems that they're trying to solve are quite related to geometry. So this actually induced, motivates to think about the problems. Can we use some geometry-based models to solve all these kind of problems? And yeah, as I mentioned, our focus is to use something called QC geometry to solve the problem. So this is sort of the motivations of our research. So now, before I talk about the application, I think it's nice to at least say a little bit about what quasi-conformal geometry is. So, but I try to avoid all the mathematical detail, but just give you a taste, a flavor of what quasi-conformal geometry is about. So basically, conformal geometry and quasi-conformal geometry is to study shape deformations. So you have a shape, and then you have some distortions, some deformations. Then we want to study the patterns of deformations. So this is the ideas of quasi-conformal geometry. So you can imagine that in the real world, so there are a lot of deformations. So everything is deforming. So there are a lot of deformations. But then what is conformal deformations? So basically, a conformal deformation is a deformation which preserves the geometry at least locally. Preserve the geometry locally. So this is actually one of the very good examples to illustrate what conformal deformation is. So we have a planar image. Globally, you can see that this image obviously is deformed. But if you look at the detail in a very small scale, for example, if you look at the picture in a very small scale, then you can see that all the geometry of the painting and so on are all preserved. So this is something called conformal deformation. So just the take-home message is conformal deformation is a shape deformation that preserves angle, that preserves the local geometry. So let me just skip this example. So mathematically, we can also formulate this property as a conformal deformation is a deformation that preserves angle. So I skip this. Okay. So because in mathematics, angle will basically tell you everything, many things about the geometry. Yeah, but the interesting thing is that if you have a conformal deformations, for example, if I want to deform this human face to the 2D domain, or I deform this bimba children 3D surface onto the Euler sphere, then you see that the geometry on the surface can be well preserved on the surface, on the target surface. So you may wonder, why do we want to map the complicated surface to the simple surface, like the Euler sphere and 2D circle? The reason is mathematics, from the mathematical point of view. Because we know how to do calculus, we know how to do mathematics on simple domain, but we don't know how to do mathematics on this complicated domain. Especially in medical imaging, when we are trying to handle, for example, the human brain, the geometry is so complicated. So how can I do mathematics on the brain is also a very difficult problem. So if we can sort of transform the surface into a simple domain, such that the distortion is least, right? And then that would be nice, right? So this is some of the examples of conformals. But then you may ask a question, right? So are there always, is it always possible to find conformal mapping, right? Between two surfaces? Can we always find conformal deformation? Obviously the answer is not, right? Because if I add a lot of constraints, then there may not be a mapping which is exactly conformal, right? So you can imagine if I want to compare my face with your face in facial recognitions, then I have to add some constraint that my left eye is mapped to left eye, right eye is mapped to left eye, nose tip mapped to your nose tip, and so on, so many constraints, right? So if I enforce a lot of constraint, then a mapping, a deformation which is entirely perfectly conformal is not possible. So then we can ask the question whether we can find a deformation with least distortion, with least geometric distortion. And then yes, actually, there is a kind of mapping. It's called quasi-conformal mapping, which is actually a deformation which minimizes the geometric, local geometric distortion under the mapping. So this sort of gives you an idea. So you see, so this is an example of quasi-conformal mappings. So you see that in this case, you see the eyes are quite distorted, but we try to control the distortion, the local geometric distortions. So this is the intuitive ideas, the basic ideas of what conformal geometry and quasi-conformal geometry is. So basically, conformal geometry means you have a deformations which preserve the local geometry. Okay, so that means everything in a very small scale preserved. Okay, but then it is not realistic. In real world applications, sometimes you may not have a deformation which is perfectly conformal. Then we can also find something called QC map, which minimizes We try to find the mapping with least conformality, least geometric distortion. So that's the idea. So, and then over the years, we have been using this kind of deformation. We study conformal the patterns of conformal deformations, the geometric properties of conformal deformations, and also some mathematical structures of conformal and quasi-conformal deformation to, and then apply it to some real-world applications. So yeah, so I hope this at least gives you some. Okay, so this is the. Well, I just want to show this slide because I want to show you conformal and quasi-conformal geometry is not a new mathematical topic invented by me. Okay, so basically in mathematics, this is a well-studied subject. But the question is, in, you know, in mathematics, we always talk about existing and unitless, but then we don't know how to compute it out. So when you talk to mathematicians, they will say, well, this exists and it's unit, right? But then you ask them, how can I get it? So I don't know. So you don't know how to compute it. But if you want to apply for practical applications, if you do not know how to compute it out, then you cannot use it. Okay, so basically, the research work in our group has been focusing on, first of all, we want to develop this kind of QC theories onto the digital surface. Because when you have a 3D camera, right, the 3D camera capture the geometric objects and represent it by some discrete point. So it's only some discrete point only. So it's not a continuous surface. But then these theories are defined on continuous domain. So how can we extend this conformal and quasi-conformal theories on discrete surfaces is actually one of the mathematical challenge. Another thing, as I mentioned, is that we need to develop some fast computational algorithms to compute conformal deformation. Otherwise, you cannot use it for practical applications. And then we also try to explore the relationship between geometry and AI. And then actually, we find out there are actually quite some relationship between defensive geometry and AI, in particular deep learning. So there is some relationship between deep learning and defensive geometry. And finally, we also are interested in exploring some real-world application of conformal and quasi-conformal geometry. Okay, so that's sort of the ideas of conformal and quasi-conformal. So now let me show you some applications. So how we can use geometry for industrial applications. Okay, so one of the applications is obviously in computer graphics. So in computer graphics, one of the very interesting questions that people want to do is to simulate 3D animations, 3D animation. So for example, if you have a 3D camera and then you can capture the geometry, but once you capture the geometry, you may not have any surface decorations on the surface, right? Then the question is, how can I decorate the surface with some texture such that you can actually use it, for example, for computer games and so on? So one obvious choice is that we can actually project, right, a 2D image, right, onto the surface, right? If you can do so, then you can actually decorate the surface. But of course, when you project the image onto the surface, this projection, this mapping should be nice in the sense that the distortion should be very, very small. Because if the distortion is large, so even though you can see a cat here, you may not get the cat, right, on the face. But then we have conformal, right, mapping, which basically minimizes the local conformality distortions. So if you use this mapping to project the image, then we can easily get the texture mapping. So this is one of the techniques that we use in computer graphics for texture mapping. So this is another example. Then obviously we can apply this for a virtual actor. So because our advantage is that we can manipulate. We can study the geometric structures on the surface very, very accurately. So for example, if I have this 3D models, and then if I want to simulate 3D animations, then I have to add some facial expressions, right, on the surface. But what is facial expression? Facial expression, mathematically, is just we try to do the deformation on the surface. We want to deform it according to some kind of geometric quantities. But we have a way to do it, right? So we can actually associate the expression associated to different geometric quantity, like mean curvature, Gaussian curvature, and so on. These are all mathematical quantity. Then we can actually simulate 3D animations with different expression, quite realistically. So this is in 3D imaging. So another application will be in computer visions. So in computer visions, one of the questions that people want to solve is try to classify or recognize different surface. For example, in facial recognitions, right? So you take a picture, okay, from different angle, and then you can reconstruct a 3D human face, right? And then I want to recognize, okay, which face, right? It belongs to, right? So in order to do so, the very first step is that we need to find, right, a correspondence between the two surfaces. For example, if I want to compare my face and the wig. Or the face of Wick, right? So how can I compare, right? So first of all, I need to know my correspondence, right? So I know my left eye should be mapped to his left eye and so on, right? If my left eye mapped to his nose, right? No matter how you compare, I would say Wick and I are very different, right? So finding a very accurate matching between the two surfaces is very important, but also difficult if you have a very complicated surface. But using conformal geometry, we can actually map the complicated surface onto a simple domain, for example, a 2D unit disk, and then we can actually solve the problem on the simple domain. And then we can actually solve it very, very quickly because it's 2D domain, and then we reduce the dimension of the problem from 3D to 2D. And then after we have computer matching, and then the composition will give you a correspondence between the two surfaces. So that's sort of the ideas. So we simplify the problem. We simplify the problem from 3D to 2D. But how can we simplify? We deform the complicated surfaces. So that's sort of the idea. So if we can do it, then we can actually do a lot of things. For example, in computer vision, we can actually do expression capture and analysis. Right? For example, if I want to understand what is the geometry distribution of a happy face, an unhappy face, an angry face, and so on, then we can actually map everything, right, into the 2D domain, right? And then we study the geometric patterns. And then we can use machine learning technology. For example, we use deep generative models to map everything into the latent space, and then we can do analysis. And then another good thing is that we can actually do facial expression transfer. Okay, facial expression transfer. So what is the idea of facial expression transfer? So the idea is I have the human face, for example, let's say this is the human face of Wake, okay, and this is my face, okay. So I want to transfer my expression to Wake face, right? So this is not an easy problem, right? Because the geometry on my face and the geometry on Wake face are different, right? So how can I transfer one facial expression to another facial expression? But it turns out that we can do it, right? Because we can actually easily analyze the facial expressions. The geometry distribution associated to different facial expressions, and then we can actually try to deform the target surface such that the geometry distribution will be consistent with the facial distribution of the expression that I'm doing. So that's the this is how we do. So we can actually make some expression here, okay, and then use the computer and transfer the expression to other face. So this is another application in computer graphics. Well, another thing that we are doing with is doing some this kind of plastic surgery planning. So this may be funny, but to us, if we want to formulate plastic surgery, we will formulate plastic surgery is smoothing out irregular geometric patterns on the face. So what I mean is, okay, so if you have this human, okay, so she wants to do plastic surgery, so I can actually study the geometric distribution of her face, right? So to us, plastic surgery is sort of like smoothing out the irregular geometric distribution on the human face. So we can do it. So we can say, oh, this may not look good. So I can do some plastic surgery here for you. And then after you do the plastic surgery, then I can actually tell, oh, after plastic surgery, you may get something like this. So different is like this. So we can actually use the computer to simulate the plastic surgery planning. Okay, so this is actually one of the work. Actually, my collaborator is working with with one of the company to develop this kind of tool for plastic surgery planning. So to me, it's kind of interesting. Okay, yeah. So this is after plastic surgery, so it looks more pretty. Yeah. Anyway, so in medical imaging, we can also use conformal geometry a lot. Okay. So one of the applications, as I mentioned, is we can now study the complicated cortical surface, right? And by basically transforming the complicated surface onto the simple domain, like the Euler sphere. And then we can do computations on this simple domain easily. and fast. So this is the most important. So speed is important. But if you want to do it directly on the brain cortical surface, it's very complicated. But we can do it fast, okay? So the good thing here is, but then how do you deform, right? So our method can actually deform the brain cortical surface, okay, to the unisphere that preserves the local geometry. So for example, here you see that the brain is being deformed, right, to the unisphere. And then you can see that the sulcal patterns on the surface is well preserved, right? So that means, right, so the anatomical structure, the geometry of the anatomical structures is well preserved on the sphere. And then we can actually do the analysis on the unisphere very easily. And yeah, and then with this technique, we can actually try to estimate, right? So the deformation from one human brain to another human brain, right? And then then the doctor can actually try to analyze so the disease progressions. So we can apply it through brainstem. So we have a hardware which allows us to do same things, to analyze the brainstem and also the vertebral bone. So the brainstem, we try to study some kind of brain disease, like Alzheimer's disease. And this one, we try to study the AIS disease. Yeah, and then this is another example that we used for studying the Alzheimer's disease, the disease progressions. So here, basically, we capture the hippocampal surface, which is a subcortical structure in the human brain, so which basically control the memory, which control the memory. So we capture the hippocampal surface of healthy subjects and patients with Alzheimer's disease at time equal to zero and after 1 year. And then we try to study the geometric progressions. So we can actually very accurately study the geometric progressions. So for example, here you see the red color here are the regions where you have very, very severe geometric distortions. Yeah, and then you see that for Alzheimer's disease patients, you see that the geometric distortion is much more severe. So we can actually use it to monitor the disease progressions for different brain diseases. Yeah, and then recently there's a collaborating with the medical school, so they actually want to develop a device which can actually monitor the plaque of the arteries, so to study the blood vessel disease. So basically, what we're trying to do is that we want to measure quantitatively, develop a device which can quantitatively and accurately measure the thickness of the plaque, and then we can use it to give medical advice. So we can actually do it by, it's mapping. So mapping everything to a phantom surface, and then we can accurately study the thickness of the plaque, and then develop a algorithms and also a software which allow the doctor to monitor the disease progressions. So this is another thing. Yeah, and then I think this is also another very interesting application that you may be interested in, is that we have, so another application of QC is that we can use it to develop a device, what we call virtual colonoscopy. So we all know that doing colonoscopy is a really unpleasant experience because it's invasive, right? So if you want to do colonoscopy, you have to put the camera inside your colon and then take the pictures, right? So it's very unpleasant. So what we can do using our technology is that now we can take a lot of 3D slides, right? CT slides, and then we study the geometric structures of the colons according to many, many CT slides, and then we can actually reconstruct the 3D structures of the colon. Yeah, so this is what we can capture using our technology. And then you can see that the geometric structures of the colons can be well preserved, well captured. And even the interior of the colons can also be captured. Yeah, so and then we can, doctor can easily monitor the colon and see whether there's any polyps or tumor. Yeah, and then we can also use our technologies to sort of flatten the colons, right? And then we can study the geometric quantities of the colon wall. For example, study the conformal factor, study the mean curvature, Gaussian curvature, and so on. And then we can actually locate tumor or polyps and so on. So this is the technology actually has been purchased by Siemens. And yeah, to end this talk, I would like to just show you one, I think it's quite interesting application of QC as well. So one of the company is actually interested develop a machine which can help them to do this kind of material design. So what they want to do is that they want to design some kind of woven 3D structures. So what they want to do is that they have two types of material, and then they want to weave them perpendicularly, and then we construct a 3D structure. But obviously, the material here is not elastic. That means you cannot deform it. So it's very rigid. So how can I design, right, the thickness of each strip, right, such that you can weave together to get a 3D structure? It's a very interesting mathematical problem. But this is also the problem that they're facing. So we can actually develop a software which actually allow them to do the job. So basically, if you have a 3D structure in mind, so you input it into the computer will basically work out the geometry of the strip. And then you just print it out. And then you can actually weave them together. And then for this one, we can actually weave them together to get a hand. Okay, so that's just a toy example. But this basically shows you what we can do. So yeah, so this is basically what I want to share with you. So I hope in this talk I have shown you, I've convinced you that mathematics is not just a whole bunch of abstract concept that only few people can understand. So, but mathematics can be useful for different kind of industrial application, including graphics, imaging, and as well as industry, yeah, medical as well. Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah, so we have some time for the question. Thank you very much. Just come forward.
So Ronald, thank you very much for the very nice talk. So what you have presented are something really powerful. So basically, with the method, just one of the small applications that you show at the beginning. So you just take a picture of me, for example, which I show you a smiley face. And then through your algorithm, you can make any expressions you want out of a single picture. Is that?
But also depends on accuracy. So how much accuracy you want. So if you just want visually good result, then one single image works. So in our experiments, but if you actually ask for accuracy, so this is another story. Right, so if you ask for accuracy, then of course you can take, you know, your face in multiple angles. So that would work as well. Yeah, yeah.
Well, so this is a very powerful image processor. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks for the amazing inspiration. And I have a couple of questions. First one is, when you capture these 3D images, do you think 3D camera is better or 3D LiDAR is better?
Of course, I would say the 3D camera that the group I have been cooperating with is the best. So I think so. So according to the accuracy.
Okay. And
my face-like structures. Is,
why do you always use a unit circle?
Oh, not necessary. We can use 2D rectangle, unit circle, unit sphere. So just for mathematical, you know, computational flavor, because in some situation, right, the solution of the partial differential equation is well defined on the unit circle. So we have the explicit solution already on the unit circle. Then if we can map it to the unit disk, then the solution is there, right? So we do not need to do any calculations. So this is so it's really for mathematical flavor, but it doesn't matter. If you like 2D rectangle, you can do 2D rectangle or whatever shape is also fine. Yeah.
So, more questions. after conforming, how much faster is the computation?
Well, I haven't actually compared, but actually you can imagine. You basically you have a very, very complicated surface, right? And then with a lot of convolutions, right? And then if you want to do the computation on directly on this surface, then you really have to work on R3. So we think about, like, if the dimension of your domain for R3 is, let's say, 128 by 128 by 128, and then you can reduce it to 128 by 128. So this is at least 128 faster, right? But not actually like this. Actually, it's even much faster because if you want to handle three-dimensional, a lot of things has to be has to handle. For example, if you want to discretize the 3D domain, the 3D objects, right? So then you have to do some this kind of meshing and things, and it's very complicated. But now we can actually handle everything on the 2D domain. So the computation, I would say is
significantly. So in the future, when we have really fast quantum computers, maybe we don't need to conform it and can directly.
Well, then we can do even faster, right? Well, so you 3D can do fast, and then I do even faster.
That's
yeah,
true.
Yeah, okay. We always win, right?
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my Alan. Thank you for your sharing. And actually, 3D imaging nowadays is quite applicable in different industries. For example, for the medical industries, even our industry, apparel, you can do the 3D scanning so that you can make your shoot. So can you explain when we apply your technologies, what is the most benefits or the advantage when compared with the application nowadays that we have?
I would say accuracy.
Accuracy.
Yeah. For example, if
so how about in terms of the time, just Roy mentioned it, how about the cost or any other application benefits?
Cost is comparable. It's not more expensive.
So what is the
we just hit some light, right?
What's the most advantages in applying this?
Well, cost, accuracy, and speed.
Accuracy. That means speed, in the speed, future, I think speed. In the medical field, it will be very applicable and in terms of the accuracy.
Yeah, so this is the reason why our research has been working, has been applying in medical quite a lot.
Okay.
So actually, most of my research paper has been collaborating with medical doctor, but recently I've been working with a company as well. Okay. So
Philips would love you.
We should talk.
But the second question is that actually right now your methodology or your theory already applied it in the real industry or just still in the theoretical stage?
Some of them are already applying in the industry. Right. We have patent already.
Okay.
Yeah, and some of them is still in. At least all the application that I show you here is already applicable.
I think because in COVID-19, a lot of the doctor cannot see the patient directly, so that in the future, show that maybe the doctor can do the surgery remotely because of the accuracy you provided.
As a mathematician, applied mathematician working with medical doctor, I usually say something politically correct. So I would always say doctor are always important. So because we can actually develop some devices or software to help you to do the job.
But frankly speaking, I saw a video in China. During the COVID-19, a doctor maybe in northern part of China, perform a surgery.
Yeah.
For a patient in the southern part of China.
Right.
I think maybe in the future, your technology may help them
a
lot. Okay.
Yeah, but doctors will still be there, right?
Yeah, sure. Of course. Okay, but
right, even if I want to diagnose a disease, right? So I still need to ask their medical expertise.
Yeah, but because you can provide them the image very accurate.
Right.
Okay,
so
that they can do the surgery very precisely.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks. Thank you. Thank you.
So next we have 5 minutes break.
Okay, so next we are having a break because we are 5 minutes late, so we'll only take a 5 minutes break. We still come back at 3:20 for the next talk.
Okay,
so everyone, including Rose in the Zoom, so we're back to the second section of this workshop.
You're using it.
So our next speaker is Professor Chen Kai. He's from the HKUST Department of the Computer Science, and he's also the director of the WeChat HKUST Joint Lab on Artificial Intelligence Technology. He's going to talk about something very important: federated learning and privacy preserving, right, in the same time through the AI computing.
Thanks for the introduction. Actually, when I talked to Vic, he said that Chinese is better. So 因为我刚才听到我们有听众两次都问到 computing power 问题，你的 complexity 就是 computing complexity right and also 大家也很关心落地，就是我们的 AI 我们的 machine learning 我们的应用是否真的在实际中有落地？那么我今天的讲呢？ 主要就是来讲这两个问题，一个就是在 AI 落地这个过程中，我们的最后的一步 milestone 到底是什么？然后我们前面两位presenter 介绍的在 NLP 和 CV 这两个非常好的一个研究领域在应用算法，但我的研究呢不是算法，也不是应用，我的研究是系统。 就是我做的事情呢，是想让 AI machine learning deep learning 如何在一个 high efficient 一个 privacy preserving 这样的一个环境下面，能真正的 benefit people。大家知道，人工智能是离不开大数据的，正是由于大数据的很多年的积累，才有人工智能。那像 exactly 刚才两位 presenter 说的NLP、CV， 还有我们之前 Go 这些围棋的游戏，之所以非常的成功，在这些年非常发展非常快，就是因为由于大数据。比方说像 ImageNet， 我想做 CV 的这个 colleagues、students， 如果没有 ImageNet， 他们可能会少发10,000篇 paper。OK， 在自然语言这个领域，也有非常大的这个数据集，像 GPT-3， 有这么多，我都不知道是 499 billion words right for training，OK？ 那在围棋游戏里面呢，我们有 4.9 million 这些棋谱来供机器来去学习，去做 IL reinforcement learning， ImageNet。 14 million images， 有人脸，有汽车 ，OK， 你可以去做 training，OK， 正是由于这些大的数据，才使机器学习、深度学习和人工智能走进大家的视野，OK， 那在实际中呢，是不是？OK， 我继续哈，那我刚才也说了，如果没有 ImageNet， 大家可能一年会少发10,000篇 paper。 这是一个统计啊，就是由于这些非常好的数据集，像 ImageNet， 像 Cargo， 像这些数据集，那么使在 AI、Machine Learning、CV、NLP 这领域的 researchers 每年可以发 150,000 research papers， 150,000篇 paper，OK？ 那大家可以看出来，从 ImageNet 2012年左右，然后被 create 出来以后呢，每年有10,000篇 paper 是基于 ImageNet 在做 CV 的研究 ，right？ 正是由于这些，那所以是大家在 CV NLP 里面的研究有长足的发展。那么现实呢 ？OK， when we are 从 research 从这些像 ImageNet 像。 GDP3 这些数据以外，我们的现实生活中 AI 你落地有多远呢？其实是这样的，我们有很多这种人脸的数据，有很多猫和狗的照片，但是我们对人，比方说像在医院对病人的这种医疗影像数据是非常 limited。OK， 数据呢，每家这个医院呢会有自己的病人的数据。 但这些数据呢，是割裂的。这些医院的大数据呢，它并不能 combine 在一起形成一个大的数据，真正的大数据，让大家能学到非常有用的 model 来 predict 一些疑难杂症。比方说，最近我们也在做和内地的医院在联合在申请，怎么让这些数据呢能联合起来。 治疗帕金森病 ，OK， 一个非常很困难的一个疾病。 在另外一个场景呢，像银行，我们有很多银行，每个银行都有自己客户的数据，但是呢这些数据是 isolated， 两个银行，比方说 Hang Seng Bank 和 HSBC， OK， 他们各自有自己的数据，但是这些数据是 isolated， OK， 那每个数据呢，在银行内部的数据呢，也许 它的这个量不够大，还不够去训练一个非常好的模型，但也可以训练出一些模型，但是如果我们有一种 strategy 能把这些银行之间的数据 connected， 银行和 octopus 的数据 connected， OK， 和交通的数据 connected， that's a huge benefit to the whole society， OK， 那这就是我今天要讲的，数据是割裂的 isolated， 那如何让这些数据联合起来，能像发ImageNet 可以发15000篇 paper recipe 一样，让这些实际的数据能 connected to benefit the society, benefit the real world. OK， 那这些数据呢，为什么是割裂的？当然，大家知道，用户对数据的隐私的这种 awareness 越来越越来越强。OK。还有呢，就是世界各地各个国家对于数据隐私、用户隐私的立法和这些 regulation more and more strict。OK， 比方说，在欧洲就有一个法令叫 GDPR， General Data Protection Regulation。OK， 它就严格保护用户的隐私数据。大家知道前一段时间 Facebook 在欧洲受到巨额罚款，就是因为它触犯了数据隐私。 OK， 那么在美国呢，也有像加州 CCPA California Consumer Privacy Act。 那么在国内呢，过去的十年，那国家也在各个方位各个方面去严格这种数据 data privacy data security， OK， 那么去年也有很大家也知道如果 audience 有投资的朋友的话，可以知道去年也有很多 big data company 他们也受到了极大的冲击，就是因为他们 violate data privacy， OK， 他们的数据 is not regulated well。Alright， 所以由于这些both from consumer and from the like 国家 from the organization 对数据的这种隐私的越来越的重视呢，使得在现实生活中呢，数据并不是 connected， 并不是在银行里面，我们没有像 ImageNet 像 GPT-3 这样的非常优质的大数据模型，让我们来大数据让我们去学习非常好的模型。那现实生活它就像这个 island 一样，我们可以叫它 data islands or isolated data islands。 那这些呢数据它们一合在一起的确是一个大数据， OK， 但是现在还不能很好的把它们 connected， 就是由于这些隐私的问题。所以呢，我今天讲的这个呢 introduce 一个 technology 叫 federated learning， 联邦学习，但我不是联邦学习的发明人， OK， 联邦学习在2016年由谷歌发明， OK， 那么在2018年或者近年来在那个技术呢经过一些改良吧，然后来到了中国，然后在现在在中国大陆有非常重要的这些应用，而且这个方法呢已经开始落地， OK， 那已经有一些这个联邦学习呢创造的价值呢已经在现实中已经体现， OK， 我今天会稍微讲一两个 case 啊。所以呢就 federated learning它是一种什么技术呢？就是我医院或者不同的医院，我可以大家通过一种技术 technology， OK， 来联合起来建模 collective modeling， without compromise the privacy. 就是说我的数据呢，在不泄露隐私的情况下，仍然可以一起来建模，来建一个非常好的，比方说风控模型。那这是在我们在和国内的银行合作 ，OK， 实际落地的 case， 就是说几家银行或者是一些小的银行可以 leverage 一些大的数据，比方说像互联网的数据。 大家知道，在国内的话，有像 Tencent、阿里巴巴这些大的互联网的这个企业，他们有大量的数据。OK， 那么这些数据呢，对于银行做风控 ，OK， 做这种贷款是非常有帮助的。OK， 那没有如果没有这种联邦学没有隐私保护的话，就是很难去建立这样的一种模型。 OK， 使得这些数据呢 ，isolated 数据可以 collective modeling。 OK， 所以呢，这就是联邦学习。大家在我有几个机构，我可以联合起来去建模，但是我的数据呢，并没有 disclose to each other， 就是这样的一个技术。OK， 那么联邦学习呢，它有几个 category。OK。 总的来说呢，它有三个 category 以两个为主，第一个叫横向联邦，第一个叫纵向联邦 horizontal， 这意思是什么呢？就是说纵向联邦的话，我可以看出来，那这是一个机构，假设这是个 data from A as bank A， 这是比方说 data from B， which is Bank B， OK， 那么横向联邦呢，就意味着这两家数据呢，它们之间呢，它的这个数据的 feature 比较相近，然后呢，它们在 sample 上面呢，就每一家的 sample 可能银行 A 有1000个客户，银行 B 有1000个客户，那么这些客户的在 feature 上面。 是有很大的重叠，比方说他们的一些消费的，和他们的这个取钱的记录啊，或者是 whatever 一些记录呢，非常的像，所以呢，我可以把这个数据集呢，从1000个 sample 变成2000个 sample，OK？ Of course, it's better. The larger the better. 这是第一个，叫纵向联邦 horizontal， 第二个叫 vertical 横向。 Actually, I'm like wrong. Okay, so 前面叫横向，后面叫纵向。All right, 所以纵向的话意思是什么呢？也很简单，那可能是我的一个 bank 银行和一个 supermarket 或者是这样的超市。那么我们在用户上面，我们在人上面有很大的重叠，可能银行的客户有1000个客户，那么在一个 supermarket 里面，或者是 online。 Commercial website 也有 footprint， 这样的话，它在银行里面有一些 feature， 那么在 supermarket， 在这些online consumer like Amazon or whatever 也有自己的这个 feature， 那这个时候呢，我可以把一个人的他的 feature 从比方说从1000个维度 extend to 5000， 5000个维度。 Right, because the people, a lot of overlap in terms of the people, in terms of sample, right? But you know, we can extend the sample, the features. Okay. 那么这就是第二个联邦，这是可以把数据 connect 起来。那第三个呢，就是在 feature 和在 feature 和 sample 上面的 overlap 都比较小。 这个时候呢，有新的另外一种技术叫 federated transfer， 迁移，联邦迁移也可以使这种 case， 能够几个机构之间能够联合建模。OK， 那这就是这个联邦学习的几个 general 的 category。OK， 你可以想象，在现实生活中两家机构要去合作，它不外乎就这三个 case 的其中之一，看他们的数据。 那么在联邦学习呢，在现实中呢有很多应用。OK， 比方说像健康这一块， 像医院，那么医院之间，比如我们现在在做的一个申请的一个项目，就是医院之间和医院和其他机构之间 connected， 然后来通过联邦学习来做联合建模治疗帕金森病。All right， 第二个就是像金融，这个非常的，这个金融在这个 federally 的金融的这个应用落地已经在国内已经有不小的落地，而且有就是非常好的一个市场和一个 potential。OK， 那么还有在像这种retail， 像这种 recommendation， 在工业互联网，我前几天我还参加了一个国内一个很大的一个天然气的一个公司的这样的一个关于联邦学习讨论，就是说他们在国内有100万家 1 million 这种 enterprise like users 企业的用户，他们这些企业的用户呢，通过 IoT edge computing 会 collect many data， but those data are confidential， and how to connect， how to combine those data to train a really accurate, really useful model is something we need to think about it. Okay， 所以还有在像传统的制造业 manufacturing， OK， 在汽车的制造里面，我们也遇到这样的一些客户，一些 user case。OK， 所以在这个 federal product 这个 application。在 category 和很多这些 user case， 其实它涵盖了这个领域是非常广的。那由于时间问题，我不一个一个展开，但我可以告诉大家，就是这种联邦学习技术呢，它是在很多重要的，首先是从金融和医疗这些数据 ，especially confidential 这些 case 入手，但后面的话很多关于 IoT， 关于 edge computing。这些互联网、物联网，包括你个人家庭的一些数据，也会是一个非常具有隐私的这样的数据。那以后 federal learning 会是一种技术来去 connect them to make use of them。 OK， 那我刚才说过啊，就是我的 talk， sorry， OK， 那我 前半个 talk 呢，我讲的是 federal learning 这个技术呢，如何来去帮助人工智能来落地？我想，在这个现在和 next 5-10 years， 我想这种用户的隐私和合法规会越来越重要，越来越严格。所以呢，一种 privacy federal learning privacy preserving AI 将是我们在 AI 落地再去帮助帮助。大家的这个过程中必须要经过的一个这样的一个 process。 All right， 那我的研究呢，除了这个我是做 enabling technology or acceleration。 大家知道刚才我们有位audience 两次问到 NLP 里面的 computing power computing complexityCV 里面 computing complexity， OK， 那么他们已经在这个现有在深度学习在 CV 在 ALP 的这个 consuming like power computing power is already very very hungry， that's why Nvidia succeed right， its value exceed like Intel， 就是因为深度学习由于 CV 由于 ALP 对算力的要求极其高，这是与像 GPU 这样的processor， right？ 它非常适合像这种huge parallel 这些数字运算 ，OK？ 那所以它超过了 Intel， 超过了传统的 CPU 这种注重于逻辑、注重于分支预测的这样的一些通用的这个 processor。那么Deep learning 造就了像 NVIDIA 这样的这个芯片行业的第一的公司。那么其实隐私计算 ，OK， what's beyond the technology beyond federal learning， 它的对 computing 要求远远大于 deep learning。All right， this is something I want to share today。 所以隐私技术啊，刚才我说的这种联邦学习，它听上去非常appealing, right? Because we can preserve users' privacy without disclosing it, but we still can like build a very accurate model in many scenarios. 那是什么技术促使的，就是说还是它的个让它落地呢，是非常 challenging，就是啊隐私计算技术。OK， 所以呢，我这个研究呢一部分呢是注重在 privacy preserving computing， 我这里面加了 AI computing， 就是如何在数据保护隐私这一块去提供它的算力。 OK， 那它是联邦学习技术里面一个最重要的技术，能使联邦学习落地，那关键就看于我们的计算有多快。OK， 我们能有多快的去build 我们的这个模型。OK， 那么privacy preserving computing， 这也不是我发明的，也不是这个有几十年的那个历史了。 那么就是归宗到密码学 ，all right。那么通常呢 ，private preserving computing 呢，里面有几个相关的这个技术啊，比方说像同态加密 （homomorphic encryption）， 多方安全计算 （secure multi-party computing），OK， 还有一个就是differential privacy (DP)，OK， 它们本质的这个都是为了这个 user 加密。 一个数据，我对它进行加密以后，你就不知道它的数据原来的样子是什么。第二个就是像差分隐私，我就加噪音。OK， add some noise to make sure that you cannot differentiate or you cannot recover what is original, like plain text. All right。所以呢，在这个几个技术里面呢，他们大概这些技术呢，比方说像多方安全计算。 1980年左右就被发明了，但是这个发明人呢，还是图灵奖的获得者，是华为华人的图灵奖的获得者，姚锡智先生。OK， 他就是发明了一种姚氏的Garber Circuit。OK， 那这些技术呢，在发明之后呢，在过去的30年没有被很好的用，或者是说很难被用，就因为他们 is exponentially like computation intensive。 几乎没有像 CPU 这些技术，CPU 这些计算呢，就是很难去用这些技术，加密技术。OK， 那我在这个这些呢，我们都不是我们发明的，但是呢，这些技术呢是联邦学习落地隐私计算技术，这个关键的技术。那我们做的研究呢，使它们呢在现实中变得更加的快。 OK， 使他们能够真正的用在现实中，用在这个联邦学习之中，来去做隐私技术或者隐私人工智能。那么我要讲的就是今天讲的呢，后面我们的最近的研究主要围绕在同态加密这一块，但多方安全计算 MPC 这个技术呢，我们也在做研究。 OK， 那我来讲一下这个它为什么我们选择。 HE 是因为它从 conceptually， 它从概念上来说呢 ，HE 是非常一种大家都能理解的一种方式。那比 MPC 那个要简单，从机制上来简单，但是它在 power computing power 上要求很高。那这个是说，它是一种 encryption technology that enables us to compute on encrypted data， 它就是很简单，就是说我如果满足 HE 是这样的，我有两个数 U 和 V。 OK， 那么我对 U 加密以后 ，OK，V 加密以后，我是 U 加 V， 它们之和后的加密，这个等式是 preserved，OK，、okay? 第二个就是乘，两个数相乘，是它们分别加密后的数的这种相乘后的这种加密，这个加密，这个两个括号我就表明它是 HE。 OK， homomorphic encryption。 So， 当你满足这样两个这个等式的时候，就是这种加密技术满足这样两个一个加法同态和乘法同态以后呢，它就能很好的支持我们在深度学习、在机器学习里面做训练、做模型、 这个里面所需要的这些计算。OK， 那么有了这个呢，我们是怎么做呢？但是这个是非常的这个耗计算资源的哈。那这怎么做呢？以前我没有加密的时候呢，是说我假设有几个 party， 有几个参与建模的这几个哈，这个地方是用机器，当然这个可能是一个医院，那个是可能是一个银行 ，alright。那么如果我要怎么样去保持这个隐私呢？就是说我在我每个机构或者每台机器都有自己的数据，那我们数据以前是说我这个计算出来一个梯度或者它的 parameter 之后呢，我们都会汇聚到一起来做一个平均，然后再把这个梯度再返回到每个。那在这个过程中呢，因为没有加密的话，它就会通过这些梯度啊，通过这些 parameter 参数的就会 disclose， 可以反推回这个用户的隐私。那么现在呢，有了这个同态加密技术呢，它就是说我的数据仍然 OK 在这个机构内部或者在我的机器内部不会传出来，那我的数据的呢这个参数或者 gradient， 大家知道如果知道怎么去训练模型的话，它都是从这个数据里面训练，一般用这种 gradient descent。 OK， 我的 gradient 计算出来以后呢，我对它进行一个同态加密。 OK， 加密后的数据呢可以汇集到一起来做一个加法或者乘法运算。那由于呢我这个地方的我这个同态加密呢是符合这些加法运算和乘法运算，所以我们加密后的数据呢，比方说我在这个服务器上做过加密后，这些数据呢再返回到每个机构，那每个机构根据自己的密钥把这个解密就可以看到。 OK， What's wrong？哦、oh, ，OK， yeah， so 加密后的数据呢再返回来。那由于这个homomorphic encryption 是非常的困难去解密的，所以在这个过程中呢，所有的数据都是以加密的形式存在，所以没有人能够通过解密把这些数据得到，然后推出原始数据。在这个过程中呢，我们可以看到有几个，首先我用户的Original data 原始数据是没有离开过自己的机器，我只有模型离开，模型是在数据上经过处理后的一个中间数据，但模型即使被别人知道的话，也会有通过一些攻击的手段可以反推出数据。那我这个地方通过加密技术把这个模型加密，然后这个加密技术呢又使得这个模型加密后呢还可以进行自由的这种加法和乘法运算，这样就保持了这个图灵的完备性。所以图灵完备性，所以你的计算都是不影响的。OK， 就是 protected， 这样没有人。这种情况下面呢，你即使用了 cloud， 比方说你用 Amazon， OK， 有了这个技术，你可以把你的数据放在 Amazon 上面，然后再把在 Amazon 上进行计算，然后再把结果拿回来。Amazon 是无法了解你的原始数据是什么的。OK。这是一个是这样的一个技术 ，OK。那么所以呢，我们在这个里面用了这同态加密呢，使得这个过程中呢是 very secure，OK。Okay? It's impossible for you to decryption，OK、okay?。那 this come， 我们知道没有免费的午餐 ，All right，there's no free lunch。为什么这么好的技术发明了这么多年，但是没有被用起来 ，All right，that's something。We need to think about, right? 就是因为这些数据好，但是呢，它对 computing communication 的要求是非常高的，比深度学习对 GPU 的要求还要高，高很多倍。All right? 所以我们可以看出来，在这个过程中，这个思想很简单的这样的一个HE， 那你要真正的用起来的话，需要有非常底下这个知道这些，比方说做Computer architecture， 做 GPU 这些architecture design， 甚至做到 ASIC 芯片级的这种 acceleration， 才能使它能够 feasible， OK， theoretical feasible to practically feasible is a huge efforts we need to conquer. That's something here, all right? 所以, 这个同态加密技术呢，它对算力的要求呢，是从这个明文到这个PHE，就是一个部分同态，它只支持加法的部分同态呢，有100倍以上的这种算力的要求。那从部分同态到全同态，加法、乘法同态有100倍以上的这种算力提升，这是我们在测试过程中得到的。所以呢，你可以看出来有10000倍以上的这种 computing power requirement, very huge. 第二， 我们在加密模型以后呢，我们的一个数假设是一， OK， 它本质上在计算机表示出来是一个可能是一个八个 bit 或者是很小的两个 bit， OK， 那么那通过这个加密以后呢，它可能变成2000个 bit， OK， 所以它的体积会变大， All right， 所以它对计算和对通信 communication 要求都非常高，那这是主要的 challenge，是它在过去的这个很多年很难被用。那我们的研究在这里面如何去加速 ？OK， due to timing limitation， I just show that we did a lot of effort， OK， in speed up， in acceleration， accelerating this， 所以我们会在计算上面和通信上面这两个维度对它进行了大量的这种 加速，那我们因为只有很少几分钟了，所以我就不讲 technical 细节，但我讲我们的这个 output，OK， 那么在计算上面呢，它其实是要求非常高的 ，OK， 那我们主要的是通过对它这种模拟计算的这种要求，那我们通过这个GPU， 然后通过 FPGA， 甚至在考虑芯片级的解决方案。 how to 来去加速这个HE，那这里面很多算法啊 ，just skip it，OK？那这是我们在 GPU 从 CPU 到 GPU 的这个过程中的加速，可以看出来，我们得到了很多倍的加速哈，我们做了几很多这种优化不同维度的这种优化，加速使它已经是 practically feasible，OK？practical feasible，but still slow，OK？ 很慢。 Alright， 那么我们在下一步呢？我们这是我们现在的研究加速的结果。OK， 那同时呢，我们在做 GPU 加速的时候呢，我们也看到了这个 GPU very expensive。Alright， 非常贵，所以它这个性能虽然提高，但是它的 price is also expensive。所以它性价比仍然还仍然，因为它本质上仍然还是一个通用的这个芯片。Alright。 那我们也在现在这分析，我和我的学生一起在分析，他们就是在从 CPU 到 GPU， 到 FPGA 到 ASIC， 这样从芯片级的去解决，在同态加密解密，在这个联邦学习中的这些问题，当然我们也有一个这样的一个technique startup 在去 do effort，OK。 在通信上面呢，我们也做了大量的优化啊。这个just skip it， 就是在通信上的这个，刚才我说过，通信上的优化呢，我们分为在一个数据中心的内部的优化和不同数据中心之间的优化。OK， 那我过去的10年都是在做这个数据中心的优化，所以呢，我把之前的研究呢也用到了这个。 去解决联邦学习在落地过程中的困难，那我们在通信上优化呢，在落地的场景啊，就是我们也和国内的机构合作，在落地的真实场景，我们有60%几的这个提升，这是在仅仅是通信啊，那的上面的优化带来的提升，在实际的在不同的这个数据中心之间，假设我有一个联邦。 有一个公司是在香港，另外一个公司在北京，那我们之间要去联邦的话，我要通过 Internet，All right，那这个时候传数据也是很慢，所以我们在这里也做了这样的优化，使它的这个性能可以提高84.3，OK，大致的一个impression，OK，那最后呢也还。 一个和香港非常相关的一个 project， 跟大家一分钟时间介绍，就是我们之前呢刚刚有一个香港政府 sponsor 的一个 SIM project， 在这个 project 呢我们要做一个这样的一个我叫它 HKYIC Turing Our Cloud， 就是我发现在我们香港呢还没有一个这样的一个适合大家做研究，大家做一些 AI 的这些 machine learning 或者 big data analysis 这样的一个 platform 一个平台，我们可能用 Amazon， right？ It costly， right？ 那我在这个 project 里面想做的就是一个叫起了一个很亮的名字啊，叫图灵平台。我希望这个图灵平台呢是一个from bottom up。我们不仅我一直是在做的这个是 scalable computing infrastructure， 包括我现在做的联邦学刚才介绍的东西都会应用到这个平台里面，这样建一个一个 open 的 AI platform， 能给我们的这个联盟里面的如果做研究对深度学习对算力对隐私对数据重要的还里面还有一个叫 CityNet， 我们想去做这样的一个数据集叫智慧城市香港智慧城市数据集，我们已经在和 Transport Department 运输署Observatory 天文台合作，那我们希望把这些数据呢能够变成一个智慧城市，这里面当然不仅是有交通的数据天文的数据，我们后面还会有一些比方说和医疗相关的和金融相关的数据，我们正在做这样的 effort， 我们希望有一个这样的一个通一个公开的平台 Turing AR Cloud， 还有平台里面呢有一个这个 CityNet 这样的一个database， 能够帮助到大家帮助到香港来建设智慧城市，谢谢大家。
Now it's a question time. Maybe we can still have time for a few questions. Anyone? Yeah, please step forward.
我想问一下，以刚才一开始说很多银行可以把他们的数据都放在一起，然后联邦去分析，但是他们本身是有解密，要解他们的密，再加你的密，然后才开始分析，对吧？
是这样，在银行里面目前落地。我是说真正的可以落地可以创造 revenue 的 case， 他们的数据不是放在一起，比方说我跟你说一个 case， 就是有一家大银行，因为我们合作的 confidential 不可以 disclose 它的名字，有一些大银行 OK 互联网银行，它就有后面有一个大的互联网公司的数据维度，那它就是作为数据的一方 OK。那另外有一个银行，比方说是一个小一些的银行，这些银行呢，他们在去建他们，比方说用户的贷款的或风险控制的模型的时候呢，他们数据不足，他就可以通过联邦学习，通过刚才介绍这套技术呢，和这家大的银行进行一个联邦，这样的话，他们可以这两家银行在一起可以在分别不泄露自己的用户隐私的情况下面。来帮助小银行得到一个很精准的模型。我讲一个数字啊，这个小银行呢，可能给这个大的银行呢，他就给了一个加密后的1000个客户的这个比方手机号 phone number。那么这个大银行呢，通过自己的这个自己这个数据呢，发现有99% 99% 99% 99% 的用户是重叠的，这个时候他们又有一个纵向联邦，就相当于小银行有这个数据，有这1000个数据的某些维度，可能是20个维度的这个 feature， 但是大银行呢，有因为大银行后面有互联网公司，它也可能有另外有1000个维度，这样的话就帮助这个数据变成了1000多个维度，这样的话可以训练出非常好的模型。
那为什么那家大银行要帮那个小银行呢？
因为 pay。
哦，他付钱。
Yeah, that's right. That's a business model.
明白了。
Yeah,
那他们
这样是很好的，就是这小银行可以 通过精准的模型来控制自己的，或者是能给更通过贷款得到更多利润，然后呢大银行呢通过 share 它的数据，但是不 share 隐私的情况下面，就是 with knowledge sharing without disclosing privacy、
嗯、
that's a good good thing right。
所以他们首先就要把他们本身 解了密给你去分析，然后你才能看到他的数据吗？
用户对
他就是在密态下
分析完了以后把 model 给你 cannot see， 小银行看不到大银行的数据， OK， 他看到的只是最后的一个模型 model、
嗯、
because 数据 is encrypted。
明白了。
OK， 然后 technically 它根据这个 model， 它是cannot infer what is original data。
嗯
，that's a thing， yeah。
一个我们现在有一个不知道有没有用过，就是那个 Google Map 有没有用这个联邦学习？还是我们的数据就给了它了，没有加密？
现在的话是这样，现在 I guess no。
哦。
Yeah, but it will. 当你的数据立法，当我们的法律越来严格的时候呢，会，我想有一天会 ，Google 是不可以。像 Facebook 用了 Europe 的数据，它就 get a like a lot of million fine for Europe.
那所以理想的状态下，应该他们也用这个 federated learning，
right？ 而且要得到用户的这个permission。比方说这个时候呢 我用户 generate 数据，那我如果想把这个数据 share 给 Google Facebook， I may get some pay from them、
嗯、
that's an ideal case。 但是现在的话你的数据其实是被他们用、你的隐私被泄露，但是 that's right OK，
太可惜。好，谢谢。
So thank you, Clive, for the very interesting talk. So I have one question. So if I have a very big database, for example, for a company, okay, we have a company, and then we have a very accurate a large database, and we can train a very good model. So can I use the model to generate some data, and then I give the data to you? Will that generated data be useful to you?
Yeah. So that's a very good question.
Right, will that accelerate the computational things? Because I'm really giving you some data, even though it's generated by a model, but it's by a very accurate model.
Yeah, that's exactly a very, very good question. It's very good. Although I'm not the researcher for this area, for this particular problem, I can think that that's a way. If you use a model, generate a lot of data, and provide that data to other like company, organization who needs the data, that might be a way. Yes. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, so we move to the last talk of this workshop. So the last one is about the STEM education related. So Professor Tim Wu, from the Department of the Electronic and the Computer Engineering. He's also the founding director of Center for Global and Community Engagement. And he's going to explain to us, I think, the very excellent robotics training at HKUST. So welcome, Professor Tim Wu.
Okay, so thank you for invitation. So I'm honored to stay here to share the experience about how can we train the student. Now, and the previous speaker mentioned that they need a lot of AI application, no matter from the technology, mathematics, and also the computation part. But the other ones, we also have to think about that. How can we empower the student, let them to prepare for the challenge in the coming futures? Because we know that the global challenges are really, really complicated. Even that right now, the COVID-19 is not only talking about the health only, also about the learning. Just like right now, we have a new normal to teaching the cars as we make small. So even for business or even for psychology, the people stay at home for a long time, then how can they prepare for the future? Now, when we talk about this one, when we see the student, one thing that align with the topic with AI, I would like to share something that what our student do some series on initiate projects after our training. Now this is let me see whether this one can pay. Now this is a robot competition. This is a humanoid robot. So from this one, the part is that they have to develop the algorithm to identify where is the robot, and then do the do some kind of competition over there. So the case, how can they learn the part? This is the student, they did it. Now the other one, besides this, they also have some idea because in the team, after we training them the basic skill, they have to explore their ideas to try to make the dream come true. The other two projects that, one thing that they do the part is about, let me see whether this is another one, okay. And maybe I can show the video for later one. Now this is another one. This group of the student, he find that it is a really challenging for some people. They are hearing impaired, and then this is really difficult for them to listen to the message. So at that time, they think that they take the video like this one. Do you know what he say? No. But actually, what they did, because they tried to recognize the motion of the lips, then after using the AI algorithm, they find that the message is called an ambulance. So in case that some people, they really have some challenge on this one, then they can, using the motion of the mouth, the lips, and they can also find the part. Now, the other one, and maybe I can try to see whether this is, let me see whether this is good, okay. Now I stop it first, and then I try to show it in another video. And so I share this one. This is a 5-year project student. What he do it, they used to build a humanoid robot, use the motion prediction, and they also learn from the model using some AI algorithm to the deep learning to know that how can the robot being moving, and even that there's some kind of external force to do that. So these are the model they build from this one. So from here, you will see that a lot of the students, they really have a talent to try to apply the AI in the different aspect. Now then, how can we train the student to prepare for this one? So actually, we have a team. We call the HKUST Robotics team. So this one mainly is a drive by making the robots to join the competition. So in there, what we have with this is a family of a culture, creativities, knowledge, hands-on experience, problem solving. Very important word is about teamwork, because we know that nowadays when we are the expert in some areas, but we have to work with the other people. So how can we appreciate the work with other people? How can we learn from different cultures? It's very important part. So if you're interested in that one, you are welcome to find us and get to know more about what we are doing. Now, some of them is a robot in underwater. Some of them is a land robot, and some of them is fully automated. This is using the algorithm. There's automatic cars racing from that one. So even for make use of the humanoid robot, we can also make a line dance. So this is a lot of the interesting part we can move on. Now, let me tell you that after 1 year, how the student feel. If you try to interview them, what they have learned and what they are doing, I think maybe I have to share with the audios also. Auto computer sound. Okay. So back to, is it? Oh, okay. This one. Okay. So this is a video in here. So you see, after 1 year, what they have told you, whether everything is a technical part. here all night, but not okay. So for the audience in on site, maybe difficult to listen to this one, but maybe you can read the things from the text. So from the message, you know that what they drive their passion is how can they work together, how they can think outside the box, how can they implement the ideas from the prototyping to make the something change in here. Also very important that no matter if they are the senior members or junior members, they are still work together as a partners. So this is what we are doing. Now, and if the people think about it, how about achievement? From this one, over the 17 years, we got about 130 awards. There's also including local, international awards. Now in here, just now in the COVID-19, in this year, a lot of competitions are canceled or maybe postponed. But we are lucky that we can still have one physical competitions. And also we just only finished another online competition. Among these two, we got about 4 awards. So in here, so you see, if we have a time, let the student to try, let them to work with, they can drive to the very good insight. Now, and this is our wrap up in here. We have launched it about 17 years. So we have in the 3 type of the competitions, one is called the Robocon. And this year, they try to play the rugby's as a game. 2 robots work together to play the rugby. So you're interested in that, later on in the 18th of October, this is a TV program. We tell you everything about this one. So recently, we get a very good result in here. The other is underwater robots, and also the other is car racing, the intelligent car racing. Now, in here, maybe a lot of you think about that we get a very good achievement. What do we teach them? Actually, we are not only teaching these members about the technical skill, because we believe that technical skill can be equipped. One thing that we try to drive them from robot competitions to something. Now, I will let you know what it is, but step by step on that one. First one, this is a competition, what we join, but actually, this is just only the starting point. After they join the competition, what we want to do that, and let me, the noting from this one. Okay, now, first one, we have the student from School of Engineering, Science, Business, and also the IPO student, and we are still looking for some student from humanity and social science to join us. So for the cases after competitions, they also build a prototype. They will join the competitions like technical, business, entrepreneurship. Because from here, they know the technical skill set. Usually, they can build a prototype to demonstrate their concept idea. So together with the technical skill, with the presentation, they can drill better. The other one, we also encourage the student to do the student initiative projects. Because that when they have interest, they can make a lot of the project on themselves. So some of them will be even from the 5-year projects. As an engineering student, we need to do that. But most of the projects, they propose, talk to the professor, some creative idea to do the drive their dream come true. So this is, we open up their mind, let them to taste, leave their comfort zone to build something else. Now, more important that is we also, because that we really would like to do something is try to empower their presentation and also embrace about the community service and also how can we build the empathy is also the part what we are looking for. So that's why we have a lot of the training program for the junior mentoring scheme. And then this year, for every semester, in the 4 semester, our senior members, they train up more than 200 and sometimes 250 USD freshmen about the robotics, get a taste, let them to experience what it is. Now the last one is we also do a lot of fans exchange program. Because that after the competition, usually if we have a chance to move to go to the international, we take the travel from Hong Kong to somewhere. And in most of the team, after the competition, they will fly back to the main country. For us, we stay for 1 to 2 days and then try to mingle with other people and try to mingle with some people have the same passion. So we try to exchange from that one. We start from, this is a picture in here. To us, it's a very meaningful. We try to bring about this scheme in 213. First time we visit and Vietnam team together with Malaysia with us. After this year, we go to another country for competition. But at that time, Vietnam, Malaysia, and also us go to the India team. Year after year, we have more and more team go together with us. So in this time, we have all together 5 teams from 4 countries of missing together. So I think that this is very good for them and to learn from each other. Even you may think that this is some language barriers. We don't know about language from the Vietnam. We don't know about the home mother language from India. We do not know the mother language from the other countries, but they can still communicate with this one. So this is a very important part why we always drive in here. Now, and these are the part, another one, we really would like to empower us, our students to prepare for future because we believe that they are very strong in technical. But if we have chance to meet with some people from business field or some students that are not in our field, they cannot just only say all the technical terms. How can they prepare themselves to speak out and also use the appropriate term, say we call the layman term, that everyone to understand that. So now the case as we have some media interview, we train up the secondary student, go to some exhibition, even some TV program. And even you can see in here, our members are trying to explain what our robot is for the kids. Because we believe that the kids is also our future, because we need the people after a few years later, maybe 10 years later, they will join the field, they will embrace about the robotics and engineering part. So you can see this is a lot of things we would like to promote. Now, the other one, what we really want to do is about empathy. Because that one main message from us is we believe that engineering is not only the research work for making the very powerful mobile phone and very powerful computing only. If we can help the leaders and also address the need from the community, this is very important. So our theme is that we call the engineering in community. So that's why we have a lot of things in here. So you will see this is example in here. We have some kind of very interesting projects to try to translate our technologies to the youth. Even we are training our university students, no matter if they're in the robotics field, also capable to handle some basic knowledge transferred to the youth. So one more thing about this is a very interesting project. So what is this one project? This one is a one day, if you're interested in underwater robotics, everyone can join. No matter if they are the student from the FMRT special education needs, or they are the a mainstream student, they can also work together. So it's what we do from this one.
其實我哋成個活動，我哋嗰個主題咧係 iSTEM， 係有6個英文字母。咁其實由 STEM 開始先 ，STEM 咧一般坊間咧都會話俾你知，離唔開兩樣嘢，一樣咧就係機械人做 robotics， 一係咧就係做 coding。其實 STEM 唔止呢樣嘢，如果用個即係英文字典嘅方法查咧，其實佢係一個花徑咁解。咁如果我哋成日都話我哋想啲小朋友或者想啲人喺個過程裏邊咧學到啲嘢，令到佢可以開花結果。很多時候我們就會看個結果，但如果沒有了個過程的花徑，你沒有辦法可以將營養、知識傳送上去， A 咧就係 art， 即係藝術。透過我哋俾嘅工件咧，佢可以做啲靚嘅工件，亦都可以將部機械美化，又同嘅時咧又可以完成到任務。其實機械人比賽咧係應該俾有唔同嘅能力都可以喺個平台入邊發揮。所以喺呢個情況下，我哋自己就加入咗 inclusion， 即係共融呢個部分。希望透過呢樣嘢咧，將大家唔同嘅能力嘅人都可以結合埋一齊，佢哋完成一個大嘅任務。傳統嘅機人比賽咧，其實都一般會俾人有幾個印象。第一個就係通常係玩陸地啦，第二個咧又係通常俾啲比較叻嘅同學仔。咁第三個嘅咧就係通常都係男仔比較多。咁喺呢度咧，其實我哋就想做一個活動，係可以打破曬呢三樣嘢。即是教學相長的，他們首先是自己學了先，然後跟著他們要去教人，其實他們都會去認識的知識會再多一點。大學其實是社會一個縮影，如果我們能夠讓學生知道社會更加多的不同的人的能力，其實對他們將來對社會的了解或者發展都會比較好一點。
So I mentored a group with ethical minorities and also it's not my group but there are groups with some kind of disabilities but I think they all did very well and for my group I think they did better than most of the groups actually and it is very important that they can have the chance to try something. I don't want those people with difficulties or minority to hesitate from challenging something new or people with different background.
我更加想嘅就更加多學校可以參與，大家除了參加比賽之後咧，誒仲可以將喺比賽學到嘢咧帶翻佢哋自己學校，同佢哋其他冇參加到比賽嘅同學可以分享，令到更加多人認識到水底機械人同埋我哋嘅共融嘅主旨。咁其實藍色咧，另外就諗起水啦。咁啊喺細細個嘅時候咧，好多時候我哋都學嘅水同電咧就唔好放埋一齊。我哋點樣可以擺一部有帶電嘅水底機械人擺喺水度，但係佢又唔會漏電啦？其實我哋工程師係可以將一啲嘢嘅方法去解難，點樣可以將一啲冇可能嘅嘢而做得到？
So from here, you can see that we try to embrace the knowledge with the different talents together. So even from the team, we have a diversity for the team. So we also honored that to get a diversity award. And this is one of them from the world. Now, and the other one I would like to, this is a student. This one we already showed you, okay. So the other ones, and what are they doing? Now, just like what we mentioned at this starting point, we create some second wave, just like the ripple. When you put the stone into the water, the ripple will go further and further. So what is the next? After this one, the student try to do, because we empower them, let them to try a lot of new things, empower them to leave their comfort zone to make use of their talents. So some of them, they go to the exchange program. Even from that one for the UG, they also can do the research work in the other university in here. So you undergraduate doing the research work is not the easy part. The other part, some student in here, and you can see from this is a theme park. So what it is, at that time, at the beginning, they try to build the robots. There's something and put the sensor onto the hands and then make them become the games and try to play the games. But later on, I talked to them. Is there anything that we can attribute that we can put over there to help the other ladies? So at that time, we think outside the box. Finally, they do the sign language translation. So using this one, they can make use of the motion, they can do this. Now then, we try to talk to some sponsors from the theme park. Then they say that really, really amazing. Then they will get the funding to support to make this one to come true. Now the other one, how about the other student? The student from our team, they get a lot of experience to build a robot, the problem solving. Work with other students, try to build a tape for the luggage. Because you know that when you go to the airport, you have the luggage, a lot of people to help you take the tape. But the case is, can we using the robots to handle this one automatically? So they work with the other professors in the other UG courses to try to make this one come true. And also some students come back to here to help us to develop some UG course for other students. So, and also we have some students go to startup. And one more thing interesting that, and because of organizing activities, do a lot of the things, they know how to do the event organization. So at that time, the first one, the launch, a group of committees from the HKUST hackathon. This is very famous nowadays. After this one, one student mentioned that all the hackathons are on land. Is it possible to do the hackathon on air? This is meaning that by take the travel from one trip and then go back in here, finish the hackathon. So he talked to the airlines and tried to make this one become true. So we can see that if we empower the student, they can build a lot of things that we never thought of before. So that's why what we did, we tried to, through the whole process, we tried to drive them from the competition, draw their attention to build the robot, learn about the teamwork, learn about the creativities, and then they can the way to drive themselves to do this one. Now, lastly, I would like to talk about what happens to the COVID-19. In the COVID-19, the university tell us that everything to be online. We have a limited people to work, can we work in the lab to work out all the developments. From that one, even the competition is canceled or postponed or maybe rescheduled. We don't know everything at that time, but our students are still doing the robots. They are still working together in a different way. So trying to work together to do the problem solving. So even that the whole team, when we work, we stay safe, healthy, and passionate together with the learning opportunity. So this is what we say that. Finally, in this year, when we try to draw the conclusion, what we are unstoppable. They are still working, moving in here. Then I ask the question, if this is unstoppable, what do you think about the journey in this year? Because it's really, really challenging. They come out a video.
我一生人都未試過咁認真，入咗team就係一種責任。 There's a moment in your bones
when the fire takes over. 因為唔想俾自己努力白費，唔想中途放棄。मेरे
comfort zone से बाहर निकलने के लिए
즐겁고 동기부여가 있었다는 이유도 있겠지만 상황이 힘들어도 그만하기에는 너무 몰려온 것 같아서 멈추지 않았던 것 같아요. 승부욕도 있었고
喺呢架車度見到佢。
I really want to win championship in the international, beating all the other teams.
What at least I want to do is just to complete this and at least see the finish line and see the robot work and complete the competition. We can be
So this is the message we carry to all the students. Family is a very important that in the team, we all work together to try to find out what we can do and what we can do better for the team. So this is the way how we drive our students from work together. And to me, they are not just my students. They are my partners. They are my members. So we work out everything in here. So I think that I will stop in here. So any questions that you are welcome to voice out. Yeah.
So thank you, team. I know that your team is really amazing and won very many international awards. So you have a large group of students working together, like something like 50 at every year.
It is about 80.
80 now.
Yeah.
So, but you did not show us examples of the amazing robots that they make.
Oh, you want to show the robot? Okay, very simple that, because that we prepare for this one. So, the point, and let me say that, because that we just like I mentioned that we really would like to using the promotion to let the other people know what we are doing. So first one, if you come to here, the first term is UST Robotics. Then, wait, is there something? Sorry for that, for typo. And so in here, so now these are all the robots in here. Now, just only recently, what we did, this one is the one we are doing. This is one example for you. Let me share the screen because the audience are, they are in the Zoom. And okay, so I try to share this one. Okay, we start it.
咁由於我哋覺得今年個 game 嘅特性啦，就係我哋覺得首先 TR 要行得快，如果唔係 TR 再快都冇用，所以我哋 TR 會用咗新嘅 independent steering 啦，去做一個更快嘅全方向移動嘅動作啦。而我哋嘅 PR 係配備咗一個轉盤，等佢可以喺射波嘅時候咧，而射一個唔同嘅角度出嚟。 咁變相 TR 要行嘅路咧，就會比較少啦，而射個波嗰個路線亦都會更加準確同埋更加快。咁由於我哋想所有嘢嘅速度都加快啦，咁我哋亦都用咗兩個轆嘅射波方法，咁就希望可以令到個波可以好快咁射出嚟。咁如果我哋變相增加球速嘅話， 咁即係另一邊嗰個減速嘅一個 mechanism 都要做得夠穩陣啦，咁我哋就決定咗用一個 motor 去控制部機接球嗰個減速運動啦。咁而家嗰個 motor 亦都同時間係一個感應器去感應嗰個波究竟有冇打中咗個網，從而可以俾佢行到自動程式嘅。咁我哋個 try ball 嗰個 mechanism 咧，採用咗一個直接推個波出嚟嘅 design 啦，而 推出嚟嗰個位置就有一道閘，嗰道閘咧喺放鬆嘅時候咧就可以令到個波飛出嚟，而喺嗰個 pusher 拉行個閘嘅時候咧，就令到個波唔可以喺部機移動之中跌個波出嚟嘅。而至於independent steering 點解快過 omni wheel 咧？我覺得係因為首先 omni wheel 係透過三個或者四個唔同嘅 motor 透過轉唔同方向嚟轉向啦。喺某一啲角度嚟講，我哋並唔可以完全咁使用盡個 motor 嘅加速同減速度，亦都唔可以好好咁利用地下同埋個轆嘅摩擦力。咁用咗 independent steering， which is 係一個我哋日常生活見到嘅直轆嘅設計。 就可以確保我哋幾時個轆都係對住我哋想行嗰個方向啦。我哋可以用盡曬四隻 motor 所有嘅驅動力同埋增加地面同埋個轆之間嘅摩擦力，咁就會有一個更加好嘅加速度同埋速度嘅表現。至於踢波嗰方面咧，我哋因為想盡快咁射曬三粒波出去而減少個波嘅 relative 嘅動作啦，咁所以我哋就唔想喐粒波射粒波嘅，我哋想 keep 住粒波唔喐，而係個踢波嗰隻腳就去喐嘅。咁而家因為疫情嘅緣故啦，科學園又改咗 game rule 嘅關係，咁我哋取消咗踢完一粒就踢三粒呢個 game plan， 就轉咗做用最快嘅時間踢曬五粒波。咁將會係先 try 五粒波，然之後再一次過踢五粒波嘅。咁好大嘅原因係因為我哋認為先 擺低五粒波之後再踢咧，會快過其他唔同嘅 sequence 啦。例如可能先擺低兩粒波，再踢兩粒波，再擺低三粒波，然之後再剩低嗰三粒波啦。咁我係相信咁樣嘅戰術安排會係最快嘅，因為呢一種戰術可以令我哋用最少嘅動作去做完最多嘅嘢啦。個場亦都會相對嚟講騰空曬俾部 PR 去踢波。 而 TR 喺後半段嘅時間，例如踢波嘅時間 ，TR 完全唔需要做任何嘢，所以 變相機手上面嘅負擔就會更加低，會有多啲嘅人手去專注翻落踢波嗰度。仲有一個禮拜嘅時間啦，我覺得好睇 member 嘅表現同埋佢哋嘅努力嘅。咁如果佢哋練習得足夠嘅話咧，我覺得喺比賽裏面做到1分5秒完成曬所有嘢嘅時間都係可能嘅。希望他們可以穩定地做到1分10秒至1分15秒之間，但是希望我們可以在真實的比賽裡面做出我們最快的時間， which is 應該是我會 set 做1分5秒左右。
Yeah, this is just only one of them. So if you really would like to know about underwater robots, now and now because this is different competitions and different things. So for example, that before I find underwater robots, I can show you how this one to do the shooting for the robot. And let me show you that something in here. So they also similar in here to catch the ball, but the shooting will be different because that they try to and find out different way to hold the ball and also do the kicking of the ball. So, and then now maybe I can show in here what they did. Now the ball is, you can see this one is one in here, and then the other one put in here, just like your hands, and put one ball on the other side and kick it. So these are the part. If you would like to know about underwater robots, so we have
other robots that you know, I know your team
yes.
is making a lot of different types of things. So I'm just saying maybe you can tell the audience that one or two examples of the amazing robots that your team built.
There's so many. But I think that's very important that when we try to build the robots, mainly it's driven by the competition, the frame of the competition. For every year, they have a different part. One year, we build the robot to play the badminton. And that year is very, really interesting that when we can do the badminton using two robots to play with the other people. We have some robots is using the underwater to surveying to finish every task. So when we try to do this, it's very challenging part is how can we work with the student team? How can we embrace them to work on in here? So if you really want to know more about all the robots, then you are welcome to visit the site and then you will see more and more over there.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Do you have more questions? I think the time is almost up. Vic, you want to have a closing?
No, it's okay.
Okay, then Bobby, you want to say something? Now we're finished. We thank everyone, all the speakers, and our volunteers and staff members from both organizations. And thank everyone, and we look forward to the next one, next workshop, hopefully.